be with us tonight as we open your word. We thank you that the things that were written, and as Paul says that, he's thinking about the Old Testament, were written for our admonition, our learning, that through patience and instruction of the scriptures, we might have hope. Well, we pray that we might see the things that are written for our admonition, even as we look at this passage tonight. So be with us to that end. In Christ's name, amen. Well, we've come to Judges chapter 12 in our not particular speedy journey through the book of Judges, and we come to the end of the Jephthah episode and sort of on the verge of moving into the Samson episode. So this is a little bit what my mother would have called, or my grandmother would have called, a dog's breakfast this morning. We're going to get, or tonight, we're going to get a little bit of Jephthah, a little bit of the minor judges, and a little bit of Samson. So put that together. I was driving this morning, and one of the nice things about both Connor and Morgan being at the same school is that I've suddenly got an hour back to myself morning and evening, not having to drive all the way over to San Bernardino. But just briefly in, and I heard that one of the leading figures, one of the vice presidents or whatever in North Korea had just been executed. And he'd been executed by firing squad for not paying attention in a meeting. I had several reactions to that. I thought, well, at a meeting at which Kim, whatever his last part is, was doing some speaking. And on one hand, I thought, well, that does tend to keep people awake in meetings afterwards. Apparently, somebody else had fallen asleep in a meeting a couple of months ago, and he was executed by having a surface-to-air missile shot at him. North Korea is a horrible country under a horrible leader. But you better know what you're dealing with. And the passage that tonight we're going to look at is, you better know whether you're dealing with Jephthah or Gideon, because it's going to make all the difference in how well you get along. So here we are. Jephthah has just fought the Ammonites, and we had the record of that in chapter 11. Now, the victory gets all swallowed up by the awful vow he made related to his daughter, and then the carrying out of that vow. But back in verse 32, it simply says, Jephthah crossed over to the Ammonites to fight against them, and Yahweh gave them into his hand, and he struck them from Aroer to the neighborhood of Manith, 20 cities, and as far as Abel-Karamim, with a great blow. So the Ammonites were subdued before the people of Israel. So this 18 years of oppression and invasion and domination has come to an end as Jephthah has had this particular victory. Then we have this next part over his daughter, and that is going to play out over 2 months. She comes dancing out to greet him with gratitude for the victory when she comes home and learns that she has just lost her life because she happened to be the first one out of the house because he made that awful vow. And she goes and weeps for 2 months and then comes back and he carries out his vow, which I don't think there's any way of reading the text honestly that says that he didn't put her to death at that point. In between, though, that event and her death, there occurs this event, which is introduced in chapter 12, verses 1 to 7, and it's in two parts. There's the war of words, and then there's the war of swords. So chapter 12, verse 1, the men of Ephraim were called to arms, and they crossed to Zaphon and said to Jephthah, why did you cross over to fight against the Ammonites and did not call us to go with you? We will burn your house over you with fire. Now, it's worth just pausing there and thinking of the sheer stupidity of all of this. He's come back. He's won this amazing victory. The Ammonites, who'd also moved into Ephraim, it says earlier in chapter 10, have been defeated. And the Ammonites, pardon me, the Ephraimites, who had never taken up battle to go against the Ammonites, now come armed for battle to go against Jephthah. And the reason is this ridiculous explanation that's given is, you didn't call us to go to battle with you. Now in verse 2, Jephthah is going to refute that, or at least rebut that. We don't know what the truth is. Did Jephthah call the Ammonites, the Ephraimites to battle, or did he not? He says he did, they said they didn't. But in the midst of all of that, they come now to make war against their own people. Jephthah had done nothing to deserve this invasion and this particular attack. And it's worth just thinking a little bit about what is going on in this particular place. Their complaint is, you didn't call us. But that's not their complaint. Their complaint is, don't you know who we are? We're Ephraim. We're important in a way that no one else is important. And you can't do those kind of things unless you involve us. Does this remind you of anything else that happened? Okay, you can read my notes later, Connor. So in this case, I know you knew the notes. But if you remember, that's exactly what happened with Gideon. Gideon had routed the Amalekites who'd come in and the Midianites. They flee, and the Ephraimites close in on them, and they stop them at the fords of the Jordan River and help in terms of the victory. But chapter 8, verse 1 says, the men of Ephraim said to him, what is this that you've done to us, not to call us when you went to fight against Midian? And they accused him fiercely. Now, it's worth trying to think through the psychology here. They'd not lifted a finger against the Ammonites, as far as we can tell. They had done nothing to try and defeat them. They haven't gotten in on the victory, and they are angry, probably out of a sense of their honor, which they have a very high attitude toward, of their own self-importance, and maybe because they couldn't get in on the spoils of victory. We don't get to share in the war booty at this particular point. Given all of that, what they threaten Jephthah is, we're going to burn your house with you inside. I mean, talk about an over-the-top kind of response to somebody. We're going to kill you. I thought of this episode when I heard about Kim, because somebody's inattentive in a meeting, putting them in front of a firing squad. I mean, the sheer, on one level, evil of that, and on the other side, the sheer stupidity of it, come together. So they've now come against him. Now, if you remember, or think back, do you remember, how did Gideon deal with that? Basically, what he said is, oh, you guys did far more than we did. You are far more important than this victory. In other words, he did a snow job on them. And he played to their ego and their sense of their inflated sense of self-importance. And he negotiated with them and was apologetic. And he, in effect, to use an old word, kowtowed before them and made them feel important. What they don't understand is they're not dealing with Gideon. They're dealing with Jephthah. And Jephthah is a very different cat than Gideon. So you'll notice Jephthah's response. He is not putting up with this for a moment. Jephthah said to them, I and my people had a great dispute with the Ammonites. Actually, what he literally says is, I am a man of great contention and my people with the Ammonites. But it's not a bad description of Jephthah. He's a fighter. He's a fighter right from the beginning. You remember his story, this son of a prostitute who ultimately got forced out of his family, goes out, he fights against the family, then he becomes a sort of outlaw robber chief, making his money his living by holding people up and being a gang leader out in that area. The Gileadites come and ask him to be their leader on a certain level, and he argues with them and says, I'm not doing it unless you make me your head. And then the Ammonites come, and he's willing to argue with the Ammonites and ultimately go to battle against them. He's a man of contention. This is food and drink to him. This is playing into his court. You want to argue with me, you just need to understand. But also it's true that we had a great dispute with the Ammonites, and when I called you, you didn't save me from their hand. You weren't here. I did call you. As I've said, we have no way of knowing who's telling the truth, no way of knowing whether they were called or not called. And when I saw you would not save me, I took my life in my hand, crossed over against the Ammonites, and Yahweh gave them into my hand. Why then have you come up to me this day to fight against me? And it's very clear that he is using the Lord's name. The Lord gave me the victory, but is also the kind of claim, the Lord's on my side on this. He was when he gave me the victory, and let's just see what happens now between us. So that's basically the war of words, but it's strong enough so that what we have is now the war of swords. Then Jephthah gathered all the men of Gilead. So he recalls his army back to war. He's gone home. Now, he's also probably not in the best of moods because he won a great victory, but he's made a vow to kill his daughter, and he knows he's got to do that. So not only is he not a man to normally deal with, but you come and tell me about tearing my house down and burning me with fire. I've already destroyed my own house, and I am not going to put up with, anyway, you can try to figure out what's going on and all of that. And the men of Gilead struck Ephraim because the Ephraimites had said, you are fugitives of Ephraim, you Gileadites, in the midst of Ephraim and Manasseh. Now, that word fugitives is a loaded term, and it seems to, it's clearly meant to be a slur. And remember, they lived on the other side of the Jordan. The Gileadites were half the tribe of Manasseh, Gad, and Reuben. They lived a little further south, and they had chosen not to enter into the land. And it seems, as much as we can tell, that they were always viewed as kind of people who'd taken the easy way out. Even though their armies had crossed, as Moses commanded them, and fought with them, they lived over across the river. And now this term runaways is thrown at them. Fugitives has more about, I think the NIV translates it renegades. It's not really that, it's more you chickens. Them's fighting words. And that's a slur, and it cuts deep to them. And the Gileadites, if before it was between Ephraim, now all of the Gileadites join. And they fought with Ephraim. And then it says, and the Gileadites captured the fords of the Jordan. Now they don't tell us anything of the details, but clearly Jephthah's army wins a huge victory. And the Ephraimites are in flight. Enough of them have been killed. They're in full panic mode. They're rushing back. They want to cross the river to get safely back into their home territory of Ephraim. And the Gileadites go around behind them, and they capture the fords of the Jordan, because there's only certain places that you could safely cross the Jordan River. And the Gileadites captured the fords of the Jordan against the Ephraimites, and when any of the fugitives of Ephraim said, let me go over, the men of Gilead said to them, are you an Ephraimite? And they knew that if they said yes, they were going to be put to death. So when they said no, they said to him, then say Shibboleth. And he said Sibboleth, for he could not pronounce it right. Then they seized him and slaughtered him at the fords of the Jordan. At that time, 42,000 of the Ephraimites fell. So they get to the river and they play a little game of password. And the word shibboleth is a meaningless word. It means ear of grain, but it was a word that was hard to pronounce for the Ephraimites. They didn't say it quite right. Actually, it's interesting. In the Hebrew language, there is a letter called variously, it looks like this. And if you put a dot on one side, it is pronounced with an SH. And if you put it on the other side, I just actually did that backwards, this way is sheen and this way is seen. And it's like a shibboleth. But, you know, we all know that. So I was reading something recently and the fellow said, well, if you ask a Virginian to say the phrase out about the house, you can tell he's from Virginia. And I thought, no, that's the game you guys play on me as a Canadian. Say out. So if I was smart, I'd go to the river and I'd say out about the house or something of that, rather than out about the house the way God intended you to say it. And so we can all think of these regionalisms that come. And probably if you're from another part of the country, people pick you up every now and then on a certain word you say or a certain thing you say. You know, it's stereo. You can tell somebody from Boston. You can tell somebody from New York. I sat my first year of seminary taking Hebrew from a fellow who just finished his second PhD. First one was in New Testament at Dallas. The second one was in Old Testament from Harvard. And he was just coming back, and he had the thickest Brooklyn kind of accent. And I'd sit there thinking, how can anybody so smart sound so dumb? Even his children called him Elmer Fudd because of the way he kind of talked. Well, now that little regionalism becomes a matter of life and death. And the numbers are staggering if we're to understand it. And there's a debate among scholars about how we take these particular terms. But as it reads, the most natural way to read it is that 42,000 Ephraimites were killed. There's another way of reading it, which is debated back and forth, but the term Eliph seems in some contexts to mean a contingent, a band, a military contingent. So it may not be 42,000, it may only be something closer to 4,000. However you name it, Israel's now killing themselves. They are committing harikiri, killing them on this particular basis that they don't pronounce words correctly. And you can just think of the amount of blood that's spilled and the amount of suffering that's occurred. And it's a sign of Jephthah and his leadership that while he has become the deliverer of his people on one level from the Ammonites, he's become the destroyer of his own family, and in a certain sense, the destroyer of one of his own tribes, because, and Ephraim, on the larger measure, just to go back a little bit to say something I should have said earlier, when Ephraim approaches Jephthah, there's no sense of thank you for what you've done. Thank you for the relief that we've been given. And there's no sense of national unity. There's no sense of we're brothers in this together. This has now become a kind of civil war, and it's going to get worse. The book is going to end with a massive slaughter of Israelites of one another, so that one of the tribes is virtually wiped out, the tribe of Benjamin. And it's a symbol of how desperate the nation is, how much it's falling apart, and how it's disintegrating at that. And so then we have the final kind of statement about Jephthah made in verse 7. Jephthah judged Israel 6 years. Then Jephthah the Gileadite died and was buried in his city in Gilead. And he is gone, but not lamented. There's no sense of him leaving anything positive in terms of his life. So I think there's just several things I want you to notice. First of all, and we're going to see this and we'll talk about it later, but Jephthah is a kind of tragic hero. In one sense, he's rather admirable, in a very limited sense. I mean, he was somebody who began with everything against him. It was not his fault that he was the child of a prostitute. It was not his fault that his father had all these sons who conspired against him. It was not his fault that he was thrown out. And he, on one level, rose to show his skill as a warrior and as a leader enough so that when they were desperate, he's the one to whom they turned, and he led his people to a great victory. But he had this huge flaw, and the huge flaw was that, and this great absence. The absence was of any genuine evidence of a character touched by the Lord, and the great flaw was that his mouth would say rash things, and it's interesting. With his mouth, he killed his daughter, and because of their inability to speak properly, he'll kill the Ephraimites. And so that's the major part of the story. The second thing that comes out of this is that the Lord is significantly absent. With the one brief statement that the Lord empowered him to gather his army, the Lord plays no part. It plays no part in Jephthah becoming the king or the leader, no part in terms of directing him to do battle, no part in telling him how to do this. You remember back in chapter 10, they have sinned, and he is not going to deliver them anymore as he had. In one sense, could you say they've been delivered? Well, the Ammonites are not their problem. But now, Jephthah's their problem, and they've got to live with that. And it's, to use the language of Romans chapter 1, the Lord's taken his hand off. He's given them over to themselves. And that's one of God's great judgments. And the third thing I've already mentioned is this absence of any sense of national oneness or national unity. So I've talked to you a little bit. Let's see what things that you think are significant about the Jephthah story, things that we should note or at least observe or be aware of, any things that occur to you, for better or for worse.
I'm sorry to go back to chapter 11 because mm-hmm. I wasn't here last week, and I'm sure you talked about this, but Jephthah and his vow that he made. So he swears something before the Lord. He makes an oath before the Lord. His daughter comes out of the tent. She's the first thing that walks out of the tent. I don't know what he expected to come out of the tent, but
His house, not his tent, but
wherever it was.
Yeah, well, there's a slight difference because animals were sometimes kept in a house. They'd never be in a tent. So that I'm not just trying to trivialize. There's some difference there.
So out of his house, and then he must explain this to her, and she says, "Well, you've given your word to the Lord. Do to me just as you've promised," which sounds submissive and devout, perhaps. It's actually an amazing response. My question is, was it a greater sin for him to carry out his vow, or would it have been a greater sin for him to break his vow and say, Lord, I made a foolish vow, and not carry it through?
Well, there's two options he had other than keeping the vow. One was, the Old Testament is very clear that you are not to kill a child. Children are not to be sacrificed. That's said five or six different times, and thou shalt not commit murder. This is an act of murder.
Yeah.
Clear, simple murder. And God has refused to accept any animal sacrifice or any human sacrifices, because the word is for a whole burnt offering, which meant she was to be killed, put on an altar, and totally cremated at that point. Only it wasn't viewed as a cremation, it was viewed as a sacrifice. So he could do that, which I believe he did, or he could have said, I made a foolish vow, Lord, whatever punishment is due, I will accept. Or he could have known Leviticus chapter 27, which allows a monetary buyout of a vow. So he was either ignorant of the scriptures on one level. Well, he's totally ignorant of the scriptures, and his ignorance kills him. It kills her at this particular time. So in terms of the greater sin, it would always be the act of murder. I mean, there's no, you can't, well, other than the sin of blasphemy against God, that would be the supreme sin. And an act of loving courage would have been to say, I deserve to die for that stupid vow. You don't deserve to vow. But on that level, he was a coward. She's remarkable in her submission to something she shouldn't have had to submit to. Now, there are some who take this whole thing that the sacrifice was carried out, that she became a perpetual virgin and never married. But that's not what the vow was about, and you have to read a whole lot into the text to try to get there. So, that satisfy your question at all?
I have a question. That is the Jephthah mentioned in Hebrews 11, is he not? Jephthah being mentioned in Hebrews 11, the faith chapter.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering what there is being praiseworthy about him.
I suppose, I mean, it says there that the Spirit of God came on him and he rallied the nation and he went and fought and defeated them. And I think in that sense, he showed some kind of faith and trust in the Lord. But you have that problem in several places in Hebrews chapter 11 of faith that is faith, but it's a flickering faith among a whole lot of other stuff. Samson is on that list, and as we'll see in the next chapter, there's very little about Samson except these rare moments when he calls on the Lord, and the Lord in his grace gives him the victory. So even though Jephthah was a man of great sin, there was this moment of faith that God still honors. And I think there's both a blessing in that and there's a danger in that, because the New Testament makes it fairly clear that by your fruits you shall know them. And it's only because Hebrews chapter, I mean, if all we had was the Old Testament, we would say, Jephthah, there's no way he is among the believers. Just like we would say about Lot. Now, Lot chose Sodom and he deserved what he got. And yet Peter calls him righteous Lot. So if we only had the Old Testament, we would never say they were saved. But on the basis of the New Testament, it's really hard to say they're saved. Except God does. So at that sense, the Lord can see things that we can't see sometimes. That's the only way I can put it together.
Yeah, thank you.
What are you wrestling with there?
Just the idea that we can identify true believers by their fruits. Is a sense that we can... We can, to a limited degree, identify people who are authentically God-fearing people by their way of life positively, but that we can't necessarily, doesn't necessarily go the other way around. Maybe where we can say that God has not adopted someone because they are living a wicked life, or they have serious character flaws or besetting sins.
There's a larger theological framework in which let me put it in this way. There's a way of looking at faith that turns it into a kind of momentary transaction. I went forward, I prayed the prayer, I'm saved. Mm-hmm. And there's no evidence of fruit in that person's life for a lot of years, as you watch and you look. And I think the New Testament comes and says, the evidence of faith is endurance in the faith, and it is the evidence of the presence of the Holy Spirit in someone's life, demonstrating that. But sometimes there's a question. I was reading the thing that Carl Stevenson that was on the email today, and Carl's wrestling with, I made a statement of faith when I was 6 years of age and I believed in Jesus, but sure wasn't much fruit that showed up for a long time. And he talks about 15 years in the pig pen or something. Is that what the statement is? And says, I don't know whether I was really saved at that point or not. I think the great danger for us is to give false assurance to somebody and say, oh no, if you prayed that prayer when you were six, even though you're doing all these things, I would always approach that person as an unbeliever at that stage. If I'm wrong, that's wonderful that they're really a believer. But I will not assume they're a believer because they say, I prayed this prayer, and there's no evidence sure. of the presence of the Spirit in their life for a long time. But Lot says, or tells me, I mean, the story of Lot tells me,
Of course, all of the characters mentioned by Peter or the author of Hebrews necessarily were Old Testament saints.
Right.
May it have something to do with the fact that before the promised Holy Spirit was given, the Spirit would come upon particular people in extraordinary circumstances, like Jephthah, but there wasn't a continual indwelling of the Holy Spirit that's given to us now that will sanctify us over time as we submit to God and change us. Do you think that looking at somebody's life, his words, actions, the way they treat other people's personal spiritual practice, spiritual disciplines, and all of those things might be more of a clearer indicator of someone's spiritual condition now than it may have been in the Old Testament?
Yeah, there's a certain mystery in the Old Testament about if I hear the Lord right in John 3, before the cross, before the resurrection, Jesus could look at Nicodemus and say, you have to be born again. So regeneration occurred prior to the, to Calvary. And that implies some change, and yet it's not the new covenant blessing that's promised in Jeremiah and in Ezekiel. So there clearly is a difference in terms of the internal reality of what God does life in the life of a believer here and now. But in the final analysis, Paul's call to the Corinthians, examine yourselves to see whether you're in the faith, prove yourself, act like men, is, I think, a great reminder that we should not give easy assurance to people. As John will say, this is the way you know that you're of the truth. And it talks about external things like works, and it talks about the internal witness of the Spirit, and it talks about love toward the brothers. So I am very concerned about the kind of preaching of the gospel or the kind of impression that's given. As long as you say these words, therefore, you're...
Call on the name of the Lord and you will be saved.
Right. So I do believe that. You call upon the name of the Lord and you will be saved. But when you are repeating what somebody else is telling you to say, that's not necessarily calling on the name of the Lord. So, okay, anything else not related to what we've looked at earlier? And these are important issues, so I'm not, I'm fine to go down whatever bunny trails we want to go through here. Okay then, let's go back to the chapter. Having talked about the death of Jephthah, we are now introduced again to the second category of judges. And we noticed in chapter 3, in verse 31, we have the first two judges, Othniel and Ehud, and then all of a sudden we have Shamgar, who's mentioned in one verse, and we're not even sure that he's an Israelite. It looks like he isn't, but God raises him up to judge Israel. And then we go through Deborah and Barak, and we go through Gideon, and then we're introduced in the beginning of chapter 10 to some other people who were just mentioned, Tola and Jair, as two judges, and we know virtually nothing about them. So here in chapter 12, at the end of chapter 12, we're introduced to three men. I've used the rather foolish title, the donkey judges, to call them, mainly because the only thing two of them are noted for is the number of donkeys and children that they had, which seems like a strange criteria for them, but it does say something. So after him, Ibzan of Bethlehem judged Israel. Now, there's two Bethlehems in the Old Testament. One is only mentioned once, Bethlehem in Zebulun. And it's up toward Nazareth, up in that area. And then there's the Bethlehem that we all know because it is where the Book of Ruth took place. It's David's Bethlehem. It's the birthplace of the Lord Jesus. And the question is, which Bethlehem is it? And it's not an enormously important question. Most commentators tend to think it's the one up in the north that's not mentioned anywhere else. One of the reasons they do is because Bethlehem that we're familiar with, David's Bethlehem, is mentioned six times in this book later on in chapter 17 to 21, and it's always called Bethlehem in Judah. On the other hand, the Bethlehem most everybody would know historically would be Bethlehem, Bethlehem, O little town of. And so I think this is probably the Bethlehem just south of Jerusalem, but we have no idea. All we are told is he had 30 sons and 30 daughters he gave in marriage outside his clan. And 30 daughters he brought in from outside for his sons. And he judged Israel 7 years. Ibzan died and was buried in Bethlehem. Well, that's a fairly impressive family. 60 kids, which tells you what? He had to have some pretty healthy economic backing to pull off that, because 60 children means you got to have a lot of wives to do that. And so he's living this very regal, very aristocratic kind of life. And notice about, why is it said he has 30 daughters he brought in from outside for, 30 daughters he gave in marriage outside his clan, and 30 daughters he brought in from outside for his sons. Why would that be important? Sorry, Sharon?
So you don't think the sons married the daughters?
No, no. Well, yeah, his sons didn't marry his daughters. That's making it clear.
Probably political alliances.
When you marry... In ancient Israel, marriage was not a romance kind of issue. They were arranged by parents largely. And you married often to make alliances with people who would further your power base. So when he marries all of his children outside the clan, he is making marriage connections in all of these different races, building up a formidable local power base. I mean, just think of where all of those tentacles of power go at this particular time. And that's why Solomon had all the wives he had. Most of the wives that Solomon, we tend to think of Solomon as being oversexed, but the issue was he was marrying, for example, he married Pharaoh's daughter. Why? Because that put him in an alliance with Egypt, and that put you in a good position. And then he married somebody else from another place. And these were not trophy wives in our modern parlance. These were political wives for the sake of marrying. And let's face it, in the upper classes even in the United States and in other places, the families, what are the, I can't even remember the same famous statement about the Cabots and the Lodges in the area of Boston. And one of them was said, they only talked to the Lodges and the Lodges only talked to God or whatever. But they made all kinds of intermarriages and they were business arrangements. So that's the point here. Ibzan is got this formidable family, but then he's got tentacles in all of this direction. And he is a judge, but it's on the basis of this formidable family, not in any godly sense that he's raised up. The next one is Elon. I find that interesting because one of the hero capitalists in our modern world is Elon Musk. The Tesla and a bunch of other things. I don't know whether this is where he got his name from or not. It means oak, as in the tree. Elon the Zebulonite judged Israel. He judged Israel for 10 years. Then he died and was buried. So we know nothing about him other than that. After him, Abdon, the son of Hillel, the Parathonite, judged Israel. He had 40 sons and 30 grandsons who rode on 70 donkeys. And he judged Israel for 8 years. So, I mean, here's a man who's put in a lot of years, and he's got 40 sons, which is fairly impressive on his own, but underneath that, there's 30 grandsons, and each of them is ruling over a city, and each of them is riding on a donkey, which in this particular case is the way of saying that that's what a king rode. David rode a donkey. That was a kind of regal animal at this kind of place when donkeys were expensive and not very common. And he judged Israel for 8 years. So he must have been really old by the time he reached that power. But again, it's a statement that there's a number of things we don't know about the judges. There's these other ones. But there's no sense that God is in all of this and that God is doing it. They're just here. And some of me questions, well, why did the Holy Spirit view we needed to have that information? I don't know, but he did. So anybody have any insights about these three minor judges?
When we first started Judges, you mentioned that oftentimes these are not geographically next to each other,
right,
or in necessarily in concurrence or sequential. So did these guys happen to take over one from another? Was it like a dynasty or?
They're living in different areas, so it's really hard to know. We're told so little about it. The only one we are told is after Jephthah, Ibzan judged. And then after him, but in what, whether it was localized or whether it was overlapping. The impression in the text is that it was after, chronologically. But there was no, as we've already seen, there was no national, there's no nation as a nation. They're really sort of a collection of tribes and clans at this particular time. And that won't change until Samuel comes along and becomes God's leader.
What was a Parathonite?
I think it probably, it's probably a relationship to the town that he lived in or came from. So, or perhaps a clan name, but it's just they didn't use surnames, so they would associate people with a place or with a clan. That's probably what it is. Okay, so now we come to chapter 13, and we're not going to move into this in any way, but notice what we have in chapter 13, verse 1. The people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh. So Yahweh gave them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. So I just want to set up the Samson story, which in terms of most of us, in terms of familiarity, this is the part of the story that we know better than others. But so I want to talk about five things quickly here related to Samson. And next week we'll start in chapter 13 and walk through his birth. First of all, the enemy in Samson's time are the Philistines. And I've mentioned the Philistines before, but it's important and helpful to remember. The Philistines seem to have invaded what we know as Israel around 1200 BC. There's a group of people who are, or they appear in some Greek literature, but mainly in Egyptian literature, who are called the Sea Peoples. And they seem to come, and most people think they come from the island of Crete, and they're related somehow to the Minoan civilization. And they move across into this particular area. And they establish, the Philistines established a five-city pentapolis. Five cities, so we know Goliath of Gath, and there's Ekron and Ezer and Gaza and one other that I'm not remembering right at this particular time. And those are their five major cities. So there's a series of city-states that they live on. And it seems that this is a different issue than before, because they're not said, although it will be said when we get later on in 1 Samuel, but the central issue here is the Philistines were concerned about assimilation and not oppression. They came in to live, they were settling there, and they wanted to assimilate into that culture, but they wanted also to keep their unique identity. So in the conflict with Goliath, in the conflict with Samson, tell me the times you remember when Samson led an army against the Philistines. There's no national battles. There are only personal battles. He's a lone wolf. And he never rallies the nation. He judges for 20 years. And he obviously has a position of respect and authority. But he is, as a matter of fact, what happens when he causes trouble? The Philistines, the Israelites, turn him over to the Philistines. And they hand him over to them, and then he breaks out of prison and carries off the city gates. And if you remember all the things that happened is because of that, and uses the ox. But Israel is interested in coexistence, and they're interested in getting along and assimilating. And they're willing to betray Samson. So this is somewhat different than we've had at any time before. Samson is the classic, I'm surprised in one sense that Shakespeare never wrote a Samson play, because this is who he loves. He loves the tragic hero. He loves the individual who has great abilities, great skill, but has a fatal flaw. The one who did write a prolonged epic poem on Samson was Milton, who wrote Samson Agonistes. Milton's a little bit tough to read. He's the most Christian of all of the major writers in English literature. I was an English major and majored in Milton, so I won't get into all of that. But it's because this tragic flaw that is deeply present with all of these gifts and all of these abilities, and yet born in the most remarkable way of any of the judges, with a virtually supernatural birth, and encountering God in a way and seeing God at work in a way that none of the others had, he couldn't stay away from women, and nearly always the wrong kind of women. So that's the enemy, Samson, the fatal, the tragic hero in the sense of the Greek whole idea of tragedy is against comedy. Thirdly, The place of women. There are four women in his life, three of them bad, at least a bad influence. The first one is unnamed, but it's his mother, and she is a godly woman who is married to a bit of a dork as a husband, but she's the one who experiences God's presence and believes God and sees God give her this son that she longs for. And then in turn, he marries the wrong woman, and that leads to all kinds of trouble. He gets involved with a prostitute in Gaza, and then he ends up with Delilah, who's the classic manipulative woman. So around that then, this is the fourth thing, there are three cycles in his life. There's the birth stories, and that's chapter 13, and the whole story of the way he was born, and we're told that at great length. And then chapters 14 and 15, episodes relating to his marriage to a Philistine woman, his deferred marriage, strange marriage, however you want to put it, and all of the battles that showed out of that. And then the third part is the Delilah events, the death cycle. So we finally come to Samson at the end of his life, and the epitaph in Judges about Samson is he killed more Philistines in his death than he did in his life. And that's kind of the ultimate tragic flaw kind of statement of the way he lived his life. Fifth thing that's interesting is that, and I think, did I put this in your notes? I think, did I intended to, or you just got a blank page there? You just got a blank page there at the bottom. Okay, I was going to put this in. It struck me, and I borrowed some of this from one of the commentators too, Samson is in very many ways an epitome of his nation. So let me just notice a bunch of things. First of all, he's born in a remarkable way, in a supernatural intervention of God. Well, Israel was born supernaturally with God calling them out of Egypt. He's called to a high calling. He's set apart to be separate as a Nazarite. Israel was called to be separate from the nations. He's called to be devoted to Yahweh. Israel's called to be devoted to Yahweh. He is like a moth to the flame, drawn to foreign women. He sees a Philistine woman and he says, I want her, get her for me, to his parents. And Israel as a nation was constantly drawn to the false woman spiritual adultery, and going in the wrong way. He experiences bondage and oppression to his enemies. Israel will experience bondage and oppression from their enemies. When he cries out to Yahweh in his distress, Yahweh delivers him. And remarkably, that happens for Israel. They do not deserve God ever to hear them. And yet he does, over and over. He's blinded as a result of his foolish choices. It's interesting that the New Testament uses the illustration not of blindness, but of hardness has come to Israel as a result of their unbelief. He's abandoned by Yahweh and does not know it. And there's a certain sense in which that's what happens to Israel in the because of their rejection of Christ. We will not have this man to rule over us. And the nation as a nation is set aside. And yet in the final end, he's restored, as I believe Israel will be restored, and he becomes a means of bringing glory to God in the victory that God wins through him at the end of time. And so there's a kind of living out the story of Israel in the life of Samson that is intriguing in terms of the way God has ordered him as a type of Israel in its sin and rebellion and its waywardness, and yet God's grace overcoming in the midst of it all. Well, we'll track our way into that as we get into the story next week of his birth, which has some remarkable features about it. Anything about that kind of quick overview of the Samson part that we should talk about or think about? All right, let's commit our time to the Lord and then celebrate the Spolstra's anniversary. And by the way, I should say again on the behalf of us all, but notice carefully how wonderfully clean the carpet is. And those of you who helped provide funds to do that, but again, Les and Fran, we thank you for allowing us to do this. And you'll notice some others came along and cleaned the windows. Well, you can't exactly notice that, can you? But when the women's Bible study happens in a couple of weeks, you'll be able to notice they're nice and clean because some of the core team for Redeemer Fellowship came, actually all the rest of the core team except Elizabeth and I, so we'll give the credit to all of the others. Don't want you to be mistaken that I did anything to clean a window here. But again, Les and Fran, thank you for all of the ways you're supportive of our ministry and activity, and we're grateful. And the Lord has removed all fattening calories supernaturally from the cake so you can have as much as you want. Father, we are reminded again that we stand by grace and not by our own works or merits. We wonder at your faithfulness to your so rebellious people, Israel. And we think of all of the ways you are faithful to us, even in our weakest of times and places. Help us to be people who walk in ways that honor you, who, as Titus is told, adorn the gospel by the way we live. May that be our part by the enabling power of your Spirit for your glory. In Christ's name, amen.